Oh. pray for, nothing left to dream about. Can you tell the difference between every day and every night? Keep on saying it was a lie. You say it's hard to say, there's nothing left to pray for, nothing left to dream about. We'll be right back.
Wherever you go, on your way home, you can see the sun. Don't be afraid that you'll burn out your glow, because you shine on and we stand free in the fading snow.
In the rain. ashamed of my own inhibiting. So take it now, unarm me from my tethering now. Live my prayer, drive home, whisper new life through my vocals. Live my Welcome to the Alita Army channel. This is Radio KAOS, the voice of the Alita Army, episode 28, movie Alitaverse novels discussion with Pat Cadigan, where we discuss all things to do with the movie Alita Battle Angel, the source manga Gundam, and the greatly desired sequels, and in this case, the novels that go with it. I'm the host for this episode, Max Tech Jurai, and with me are Star of Alien. He's sitting out the back doing all the magical wizardry with the technology. We've got Dennis from Munich, Germany.
Hi there, everyone.
We've got Foxfire, also from Germany.
You all right?
We've got a couple of guys who'll be swinging in later. That's Eddie Trigger Pooley and John Hoots. And on our guest list, we've got Cranberry Jam. Thanks for coming back, Cran.
Hey, guys.
We've got David Birch, 1982, from Brisbane.
G'day.
I should mention that Cran's from North Carolina. And we have a new guest who's part of the Army today. It's Liam Wang from California. Welcome, Liam.
Hello.
And our special guest today is the author herself, Pat Cadigan, who was the author of the Battle Angel official movie novelization and the Iron City prequel novel, and she's in the UK. Thanks for coming, Pat.
Well, thank you for having me.
Oh, we've wanted to get you on here for a long time, so I'm super excited today. So just before we move on, Liam, this is your first time here, so do you want to give the listeners just a little bit of information about how you're involved with the fandom?
I've been following Battle Angel Alita since middle school, elementary school time period, and yeah, I saw the movie in theaters at least 14 times.
Good
and
man.
And then I brought, I also brought a bunch of people to various times I saw it, so. Anyways, that's it for me.
And you've read the novels, yeah?
I've skimmed them. I haven't read them all the way through because I have some dyslexia, so it takes me a while to actually read something.
Well, I highly recommend the audiobooks. Sorry, Pat, where you go?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm also dyslexic.
Wow.
I've been dyslexic for a long time now. So I figured it out. But I'm also dyscalculic, which means dyslexia with numbers, and that's really tough. Try explaining you can't balance your checkbook when you're 30 years old, you know.
It's lucky that phones remember the numbers for you now then.
Really?
Okay, so we will switch on to you seeing your you've joined the conversation there, Pat. So how about you give us a quick rundown of your connection to Alita Battle Angel and what you're doing towards it at the moment?
Well, it all started actually when my son was in elementary school. He discovered the manga, and I always read things with him. I used to read to him when he was even an infant in arms. So reading time was kind of our special time together, even after he'd grown up, you know, quite a bit. It was elementary school, and the manga was over where we lived in the city area at the time. And so we used to read it together, And I think it's pretty cool. And he thought Alita was, you know, she was just great. And I never realized that this would be so beneficial to my career later on. And I got the assignment from Titan Books here in the UK. And the studio, one of the guys at the studio said that they want to talk. So we had this, we had a conference call, I guess. And what the studio told me was that they didn't want a slavish, absolute copy, word for word or scene for scene, of the novelization. You know, they didn't want it to be just the movie. They said, we want to make it a real book. And a little later, when I was working on the on Iron City, they sent one of the earlier scripts. In fact, I think it might have been the original script. And they said, can you include something? You mind rewriting, you know, the novelization to include some things from the original script? And I had my editor, Ella Jane Chappelle, go over that, and because I really trusted her. She was such a great editor. And I asked her if she would go over, you know, the original script and find things that she thought would fit, you know, would benefit the book, and without, you know, being too much of a change in terms of tone. And so she did that, and I, you know, I put in some things. So but it was a pleasure to work with Ella on the book, and it was a real pleasure to find out that, you know, the studio was very pleased with the work that I'd done. And of course, you know, lots of readers get a little bent out of shape when a novelization doesn't match the movie perfectly, when there are scenes that weren't in the movie, or there are scenes not in the novelization that were in the movie. And the thing is, it's like when you're doing a novelization, with the exception of Jason X, which I'll explain in a little bit, with the exception of Jason X, all the novelizations that I've ever written have been of things that were at that time filming or in production. And that's because a lead time on a book is so much longer than it is for, you know, a movie release. You can make changes to a movie up until like a few days before it's actually released. And you can't do that with books because there's, you know, there's printing and there's, you know, there's all kinds of production things that they have to do. And the lead time's much longer. So in between the time you get what's, you know, the final script, you don't get the shooting script. And while they're shooting the movie, sometimes they cut things out, or they decide to change things, or they switch characters around a little. And that's why novelizations never match movies completely. There are always differences, and it's simply because the movie changed in between the time the writer got the screenplay to novelize and the time the movie came out.
Well, that's answered about five questions I had.
Oh, sorry.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Stuff we needed to know. There's been a fair bit of contentious discussion. We've kind of tried to keep the books as a topic we weren't going to discuss until we could get to speak to you about them, but we were quite curious about the differences. From what I've seen of novelizations, the extra characterization and the extra scenes that go into a novelization aren't necessary, and the movie sort of bulk it out and fill in those gaps. And the movie, because it was compressed from the original script, does have some gaps that did need filling out. And I also find that the prequel novel you wrote really gives a whole lot more sort of meat and substance to the characters, because you show a lot of all the other characters. Everybody's always focused on Alita, but actually finding out about all the other characters and what they've been up to before Alita was found, I found was really interesting to see what everyone else is doing in that world.
Well, it's funny. In Iron City, I came in late to that one because they had originally asked Yvonne Navarro to do that particular book. And Yvonne had to drop out while she was in the process of turning in an outline. She was writing the outline, and she had been, you know, she had to keep putting it in for okays from the studio. And she didn't even have the Alita screenplay to work with. So she was really playing it by ear. And then something happened. She had a family thing, and she had to drop out. So the Titan people asked me if I would mind taking it over. It'd be kind of a little short deadline, but, you know, I said, well, you know, actually, I think that's good, because there will be fewer things that I'll have to smooth out, you know, fewer continuity errors.
Yes.
So I went mostly with Yvonne's outline, but she'd only outlined it about halfway. But that was enough. You know, it was like I knew where the story was going, and I knew, you know, what it would be. And we, you know, I had to fix some continuity errors, and I had to change some things because they didn't match the information that was given in the movie about some of the characters. And but that was okay, and I had a great time doing that. And but you know, when you're fleshing out a novelization, generally what I do is I have like a three-stage thing that I go through. First, I prosify the screenplay, which means I just, you know, write it as a narrative, as a prose narrative. And that'll usually run about 50,000 words. And that's not even a first draft, but like draft 0.5. And then I go back in and I write the first draft using, you know, description and characterization and talking about the scene and the, you know, what kind of setting it is and everything. And that's kind of draft 1.5. And then I go back in and fix any mistakes or inconsistencies that I may have put in. I rethink some things. You know, reword some things, and then I turned that one into the editor for, you know, for editing, correction, and discussion. And so I didn't have a script, of course, with Iron City, but I did have the guidance of Yvonne Navarro's outline, and she had read a lot of the manga, so she did a very good job in staying in Alita's world. It's not just something that she pulled out of nowhere. She read the manga, she got to know the characters, and I made some changes because there are things in the manga that work just fine as a manga, but they don't work okay as a prose novel, because it's just like things that will work on screen in a movie won't work just prose. It's that old saying about one picture is worth a thousand words. In a movie, you could just show a scene of, you know, the street in Iron City, and you get the sense of place just by looking at it. That has to be painted in words in a prose novel. So that takes, you know, that usually takes more than 1,000 words.
And you don't want to lose the reader by going too deep into description.
No. But the thing is, it's like, it's so much easier to cut than it is to create. So, you know, it's like the other thing that I do is I go through, see what I've overwritten. Maybe I've been redundant or repetitive, and trimming that out, that's not a problem. You know, it's always easier to trim than it is to fill in.
But then sometimes you do repeat things like thank you and good night.
Well, that was a catchphrase.
Yeah. So there's times to repeat and there's times to make sure you don't.
Yeah, exactly.
I've read, when I say read, I've listened to the audiobooks of those two novels about six times each.
Wow.
Uh, for research purposes. So I've been picking up, as you say, going, you've gone back and edited everything to try and make it all hold together and match the two books. And I've sort of seen where that sort of can come adrift, where one book sort of talks about characters in one way and the other book it portrays them slightly differently and adjusts the tone a little bit.
Well, of course, Alita is the linchpin, you know. They're very different people before she arrives.
That's true, yeah.
So Alita pretty much changes the world as they know it, because at the end, even Motorball is different.
She sure as hell gets a lot of people killed. I'll give her that.
Yeah, yeah. You can't be too squeamish around Alita.
Yeah, gotta make an omelet without breaking a few eggs. So I know that there's been a lot of discussion about the differences, and thank you for giving us an idea of why the novelizations differ. I had actually wondered when you started writing the novelization compared to when the movie started filming. Was it before or after?
Long before.
Long before. Right.
Not before it started filming. It was in production. And fortunately, the studio was very kind in letting me see pictures from the production before I had to close out the book. So I was able to get more of a feel for the setting, the way people looked, the way they acted. It was quite a while before I got to see what Hugo looked like, you know. And when you write a character and you don't have any idea of what they look like, you put a picture in your own mind, you know, because you have to see something. And when I finally saw what Hugo looked like, I went through and I made adjustments to the characterization, to, you know, some of his facial expressions or his gestures or things like that, because, you know, it was important for Hugo to appear and act like Hugo on the screen.
Yeah, there needs to be that connection of character, because I understand exactly what you mean. Your experience with other novelizations, though, would have given you a heads up on all those sorts of issues between the two formats, though.
Yeah, but I haven't really done that many before. I did the first novelization that I ever did was for a movie called Cellular with Kim Basinger and Jason Statham. And I've always described the movie as it's the opposite of Phone Booth. Kim Basinger phones it in. She's held prisoner in an attic, and she messes around with a telephone. She's a science teacher, and she calls for help randomly. And at the time that this movie was made, most people didn't know certain facts about cell phones. And one of them, because everyone didn't have a cell phone at the time, and one of the things that people wasn't widely known at that time about cell phones was that every number is stored, you know, that you call or that you receive a call from, there's a log, and the number there is stored. And so at one point, when our hero goes into a tunnel and he thinks he's going to lose Kim Basinger, he's just like, you know, he thinks in terms of losing a call on the landline. Oh, no, if I lose this call, I won't get it back again. I won't be able to talk to her or help her. So he immediately does a U-turn, you know, peels rubber out of the tunnel so he won't lose the call. And that was something that I didn't know myself at the time. And now, you know, it's like writing a movie in that way would be, you know, be silly. Six-year-olds know, you know, that there's a call log on a cell phone.
Well, that goes into the research, and I guess that being that Alita is set so far in the future, you've got carte blanche because, you know, we don't know what the technology is going to be like this. You can make stuff up.
Well, carte blanche up to a certain point. The studio had decided on the limitations of certain kinds of technology. And I put some things in Iron City that I had to take out because the studio said this is not part of the technology of the future as we conceive it. You know, I didn't argue with them. It's their property. It's, you know, I was hired to write a book for them to make them happy. I took it out. Although, you know, I put it in because I thought that, you know, if you could have a, you know, a floating in the middle of the air, you know, actual city, then you could have this. But technology is weird, you know. The things that we think will be commonplace within a few years turn out to, you know, be miles and miles and miles. Decades and decades down the road, whereas things we didn't see coming, you know, or thought weren't going to happen for a really long time, just pop up, you know, they're just fast. One of the things, for example, and of course I have a story about that, for example, everyone laughs at, including William Gibson, once poked fun at himself. He said, I can imagine people reading Neuromancer in the future saying, wow, look at this science fiction novel about this, you know, this high tech future in which absolutely no one has a cell phone. And it's because in the US in the 1980s, people got cordless telephones. Now, these were late. Lines. So they got cordless telephones, and then they discovered that their telephone conversations could be picked up on shortwave radio and also police scanners. So if you'd be talking to your dealer on your cordless phone, and the police would hear a word, and then they'd drive over to your house and arrest you. They'd arrest you.
Oh, that's beautiful.
People figured, well, if you know, no one wants a cordless phone anymore. No one's going to have a cordless cell phone either. And, you know, surprise. Cell phones worked out.
That's when the end-to-end encryption came in and that solved that problem.
Right.
I have a kind of question because you mentioned technological constraints. What kind of constraints are there? Or whether when you wrote a book, is there an example you have at hand?
Well, I don't always know. And if I'm not sure, I'll ask. And I'll ask through my editor. And my editor will get in touch with the studio or the, you know, the screenplay writer or whoever. And they'll answer the question. And my editor will tell me about it. And sometimes I will just go on, you know, on the basis that my assumption is right. And if it turns out that I'm wrong, I just go back and change it. You know, it's no big deal.
What's the classic case of the haves and have-nots? We're not shown in the movie or the novelization what's going on up in Zalem and what they have compared to what the people down in Iron City have. But obviously, any technology that's going to give anybody in Iron City a leg up, they would just limit, like they limit guns because they don't want any challenges to their power.
Oh, exactly. And I remember thinking that, wow, there are no birds. There must be no birds because people would attach cameras to birds. And so the way they've solved that is that, you know, the what are they? Those big machines. The ones that fire on it, anybody.
Centurions. You
know? That's right. I'm very old. I'm getting old, and sometimes the words fall out of some of the holes in my head. But the Centurions will just fire on anything that's heavier than air flight. So, you know, it's like you don't fly kites, and birds eventually know enough to stay away. And in the original script, in fact, when Alita and Doc Ito go to the marketplace, one of the first things she sees are birds in cages. And the first thing she wants to do is buy them all and open the cages and set them free. And that Ito and Hugo both tell her that, you know, it's like, no, you can't do that, because as soon as you do, they will get, you know, shot down by Centurions. Things just aren't allowed to fly around Zalem. And Zalem is absolutely mysterious. I think even in the, I haven't read all of the manga, but in as much of the manga as I have read, it's Zalem is very unknown, mysterious. And I did set a few scenes in Iron City up in Zalem to explain the background. And with Doc Ito and his wife, Shiren. And
flashbacks.
Pardon? Yes, the
flashbacks.
Just to explain why, you know, it's like why she's so uptight and why they're so incompatible at ground level. And I tried to make her not exactly sympathetic, but I tried to make her a bit more understandable as someone who comes from a background of great privilege and has been led to believe that things will always be this way for her. And then suddenly she is literally thrown out like garbage. And you know, how, you know, two people with, you know, equal backgrounds, equal intelligence, equal skill sets even, because she's also a, you know, a cybernetic surgeon. Two people can, you know, have the same awful experience. One makes the best of it, and the other one never adjusts.
Yeah, I did find that interplay really interesting.
There wasn't a whole lot in the movie, but I did want to make her more of a human being and less of a, you know, a kind of stereotype ice maiden.
I think you did a very good job on that.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
I really liked the prequel novel in the extra information that it gave about the movie Alitaverse, because it's clearly obvious that the way the sort of movie verse is coming out is somewhat different to the manga. And as you said, part of that is to do with what works in a book versus what works in a manga, what works in a movie. But there's also sort of key differences. And one of them is Nova and the way he's portrayed. And that's been a bone of contention between people who, you know, are more fans of the book or more fans of the movie or more fans of the manga. Do you have a feeling about how that's changed, having, you know, read the manga for such a long time, and how that character is going to be different further down the road?
Well, it has been a really long time since I read the manga, you know. I mean, got as far as, you know, really getting into Nova and his, you know, what he is and who he is and what he wants to do. And I thought about it, and there was so much to take care of, you know, to talk about, to give the story of in both the novelization and in Iron City, that I really felt that I had to leave him to be even more mysterious than Zalem in some cases, except in a couple of the flashbacks when he's, you know, he treats Shiren so abominably in Iron City.
There is a flashback where he's actually, in the novelization, he's actually on Mars watching Alita train with Gilda.
Oh, yeah.
And that's quite different from the movie where he's shown as a hologram and they're saying, well, this is the guy you got to kill. This is the mission.
Yeah, that wasn't in the this is the guy you got to kill. That was the mission. That wasn't in the script that I had. What was in the script that I had was what I wrote in the book. And that's what I was given to work with.
So the script that you had was the original James Cameron script.
Yeah. Yes, it was.
Yeah, that's what we figured. Because the scene with Alita cutting the tear that's in the movie is really poignant right at the end, whereas in the novelization she's actually cutting a water droplet in Doc Ido's surgery. And I looked at that and I went, yeah, I think Rodriguez might have tweaked that. Yeah. He might have moved that along a little.
Yeah, when I saw where she cuts the tear, I thought, geez, I wish they'd done that in the script, you know. And now people are probably wondering why I didn't put that wonderful moment in the novelization. And that's why it wasn't there.
Yeah, that's what we figured. The other thing about that scene is in the novelization, Alita's wearing armor over the berserker body, whereas I've spoken to some of the Weta guys and they were saying that the body in the movie was actually a whole new model. It wasn't. It didn't have anything to do with the berserker, which tracks more with the manga, because in the manga she actually gives up the berserker body and takes up a motable body. And it sort of tracks in the movie in that Doc Ito says, you know, if you break this, I can't fix it. So it would make sense not to use it on the motable track because it can't be fixed if you get into a big pileup and get it wrecked.
But, well, that's what I thought, but what you read in the novelization is, again, what I was given. Description of her in that old spacecraft, the doors that she goes through, the things that she sees, the big bubble, and the body hanging there, you know, on like a clothes hanger or something. That was exactly what I was given to work with. So I had to make it as magical as possible. But she, you know, she does wear lots of padding over, you know, over that body. And I, you know, I was kind of two minds about it. And then I thought, you know, she doesn't really have, there isn't really another body for her, you know, that's available, that's comparable to this berserker body. And, you know, it's like, she actually offers Hugo her heart and says, you know, it's like, we could sell this for millions and I'll get a cheap replacement. And, you know, it's like, but the truth is when you downgrade like that, you know, it would be serious come down for her, you know. And when she goes up against Grushka in her pretty little body, it doesn't last long. And so, you know, whereas her berserker body can heal itself. If you see at the end, Grushka, you know, slashes her side and the body simply heals itself. So I get the feeling that, you know, it's like Ito doesn't know exactly how advanced it is when he says, you know, don't break it because I can't fix it. Don't worry, Ito, it'll fix itself. And I don't think he's quite current on that.
Well, the sort of, from a storytelling standpoint, the reason that Alita goes away from the berserker body after Hugo's death is twofold. The first one is that she can't stand to be in that body anymore because that's the body she loved Hugo in.
Yeah.
And the second one is, if she's in that body, then the whole what we call the Zapan arc can't happen.
Yeah.
Because she has to be separated from the body. So storytelling-wise, not logic-wise, her being in a new body makes sense because it tracks with the manga and enables further stories in the manga to actually come to the screen. But if she's still in the berserker body, then that can't really happen.
Well, the thing is, there's another way, you know, speaking as a woman who's been in love several times, there is another way to look at the berserker body as being the only thing that she has left that connects her directly to Hugo. So
that is true.
You know, thinking in terms of, I can't stand to be in that body because, you know, I loved him on. versus, you know, the last bit of anything of him that's left to her. So, you know, but, you know, I think there are pros and cons on every side.
Oh, there is.
As I have noted many times in many other places, being wrong is my superpower.
Yes, I saw on your Facebook profile something along the lines of fail again, or fail better.
Oh, yeah. Samuel Beckett. Ever tried, ever failed. Try again, fail better. That's my motto. Fail better.
Seems to be working for you. I'm sort of hogging the discussion here, but does anybody else have any questions along these
lines? Yeah, I have a few. I just wasn't sure if I could bring them. So, yeah, I have questions regarding Nova and also, yeah, about him. Like, I've read the Iron City book, not the movie novelization. Mm-hmm. And I think the way he's like portrayed also in the movie, like, it differs a lot from those of the manga. And I was thinking about, is it actually the real Nova, or could it be something kind like there's an entity on the island, that's a theory of mine, like the artificial intelligence, Melchizedek, could pretend to be Nova, because he was so different that I was thinking, like, is it actually the real one, or is it somebody who's taking his place, and the actual Nova is out there, like in the manga? So,
well, that's the idea of the eyes, watcher behind the eyes, is that he can hitch a ride on anybody. He hitches a ride on Grushka, he hitches a ride on Vector, and he, you know, he possesses Vector, basically, without warning and without telling him that it's coming. And, Chris, it's a repellent experience for Vector, just as it is for anyone who has to find themselves confronted by Nova.
There's also one thing that Grishka also has a personal experience with Nova. He has met him at some point on the ground. So at least at one time in the past, he must have left Salem. So that's also an interesting thing.
It's entirely possible. But they've left all of that up in the air, and I think they left it up in the air so that they would have something, you know, some more stuff to work with if they're going to do sequels.
Oh, they've got so much to work with. There's no shortage of anything.
Yeah.
In fact, Last Order, which is the follow-on from the original series, which you probably haven't read yet, is starts in Zalem. And the first section of that is actually in Zalem. And then they go even further up to space cities called Jiru or Cathrides. So,
well, it goes
past Zalem.
Zalem is connected to something. There's a there's some kind of a column of light in the very center of Gollum. And in the script, I think it was Hugo, was speculating on what's at the other end. You know, what is Gollum attached to? You know,
that was the scene when he was dying. I remember reading that. And he's looking up and he goes, well, my oncoming death gives me clarity, and he's realized that star that's not moving is probably a space city.
Yeah.
Which matches with the manga. You should really check out the rest of the manga. It is really good.
Well, I'm going to, you know, I've read of it than it probably sounds like, but as I said, it was quite a while. Before I started the novelization and Iron City, it's like we had a pile of them in the original manga in a box somewhere. And then I discovered that I do better with the electronic because I couldn't misplace those, you know, or sit on them and bend them in half and things like that. So I went over a lot of it, but there was only so far I could go because the script, you know, didn't go through a lot. It went to the motorball, and then that was it.
Cranberry, didn't you have a question?
I did, and I'm in the chat getting questions for people, and I'm just going to go ahead and throw this out here because about half the questions are, Pat, do you have any news on a sequel, or have you been approached about writing a sequel novelization?
I have absolutely no news. I got to tell you, the writer is always the last to know and the most surprised. I've read different things, and I've read that, you know, it's like they're talking about a sequel and they're still talking about a sequel. They're talking about a sequel. And then I read that because of their acquisition by Disney, now a sequel seems unlikely, but I can't figure out why that would be. You know.
Oh, we've got a whole bunch of ideas about that. It's got to do with them not owning the IP, so they can't control it, and therefore they don't want to move forward with it.
Well, you know, I think that's kind of a shame. Naturally, I would think this.
But, I mean, the situation as it stands is that there's no sequel on the horizon, but we're not giving up hope that situations in Hollywood can change all the time. Things can be sold on. So we're hopeful that at the moment we're actually hoping that Emma Watts, who was the CEO of Fox when Alita was produced and who helped make it become a reality, will now at Paramount hopefully be able to influence there and maybe get an Alita sequel happening at Paramount. So that's our hope at this point.
You know, it would be interesting to see Brie Larson play Ellie. Well, because then we could finally see, Alita kill Brie Larson. I mean, Ellie.
That's a very focused opinion.
I think too many people would probably see Captain Marvel, but we won't go into that.
So, So guys, that's on point at the moment. Has everybody seen that picture floating around Facebook and Twitter of Alita faced off against Erica from
Marvel?
The basis of the face for Erica is actually Brie Larson.
Yeah, I've seen that. It's a well done edit, and I hadn't recognized her at first, actually.
I was thinking
that, okay, it probably has a base on a real actor somewhere, but I couldn't figure it out. And I didn't think about Brie because, yeah, maybe he didn't dare or anything. And so people were asking, and at the end he disclosed it, and it was like, wow, cool, that's it's wrestling. And she has the looks for that. She would fit that well. And she had also played in Scott Pilgrim, also a villain, so I could imagine she could pull that off. Even though she has a really soft-hearted nature as a real person, but in a movie she could do that, so why not?
It'd have to be some serious character acting, because Erica's nuts.
Erica's crazy, yeah, that's true. She's a lot, at least three shades darker than the version of Scott Pilgrim, where that she played as a villain, so she would maybe play her most vile role in that regard.
Considering her fan base from Captain Marvel, if they did manage to pull Brie Larson for the sequels, I wonder how much of that fan base would even move over into Alita and bring even more money and income for the movie.
It's actually happened because quite a fraction of them has already watched Alita somewhere down the line in Blu-rays or late in the cinema, and found a good liking on that movie, and is also very interested to see one. But I can't tell if it's a majority or just a fraction. But I think in general, more and more people from different fan bases are also catching up on that movie, and it's a growing fan base, and it's a very important part of getting the sequel greenlit by growing the audience. I mean, the best way would be to have a series if they can't finance a whole movie, something like The Mandalorian or so. They could feel in it and get the audience build up if there's no other way. Yeah, so maybe that's also a hope. So making a prequel series, which would be also very interesting.
We already have a somebody who's angling to be Erica, at least in flashbacks for a sequel, and that's Tilly Lockie.
Yeah, true. She's a bit young now, but in a few years, she would definitely work. So, and she's basically by nature a cyborg already. So, yes, she knows how it feels. You know, that's a very different thing. So,
not just how it feels, but like. Actions is like when someone plays a blind person when they can see, like they'd really have to even dabble in method acting, if not go the whole nine yards. Whereas with her, it just comes so naturally. And like, I don't know how that would translate from real life to the screen, but I'd imagine there wouldn't be too much of a coaching that would happen to be able to achieve that.
Well, I suspect from an athlete, I can't even say the word. Basically, looks-wise, they would probably have to do Tilly or Brie or whoever it was full CG and make her look like a leader, because she's also a Consular. She's also like Gilda, she would be full CG.
As she would get the mocap suit and the whole Alita treatment, basically.
Right.
While it's still in fresh in Pat's mind, one of my questions is that when you were when you told us about receiving an early version of the script and not knowing how it might differ from the final product, how was your experience when watching the movie for the first time, knowing that you had access to that original script, writing the novel, and not knowing how little or how much it would differ from the final product? Like, as you were sort of watching it screen for screen?
Well, to be honest, I felt that I hadn't actually done the setting justice, in that they tried to explain to me what Iron City would look like. And I had no photographic references to go by. So I had to just go by, what it said in the script and what I was told, for example, the trash heap was in the script. It was not described as being anywhere as enormous and elaborate as it was in the movie. And my first thought when I looked at it, I thought, oops. Fell down there. Oops. But there is, when I looked at the production stills, when they were finally available to me, there is, I don't know why I'm surprised at this. Maybe simply because I've never been in the film business, in any way. But there was so much green screen that the actors were acting again, there was very little that was actually there for them to handle, and it's like just angle of photography and everything, plus the projection on a green screen made it look that things were bigger, more elaborate, more fancier, more crowded up than they were. And I remember someone at the studio had said, well, think of Iron City as kind of like Bombay or Mumbai. And I thought, and I just said, okay, because I was too embarrassed to admit that I've never been there. And they just said, well, you've seen pictures, haven't you? And, it's like seeing pictures, it would have helped me more to see pictures of what they'd done with Iron City than it would for me to see pictures of Mumbai.
Well, Robert Rodriguez had the set of Alita Battle Angel built in his studios in Austin, in Texas. And they did actually build a lot of the sort of lower level stuff physically. And it was there, and there's rooms with power and lights and all sorts of stuff, apparently. that's actually able to film in and touch and feel and things like that. But all of that sort of epicness, the from the second level up that gets added, sort of gives it that big feel. That was all green screen, so they can't really build that on set.
Well, you know the part where Doc Ito goes in to turn in the heads for the bounty?
Yep. At the factory 33.
The only actual things, you know, parts of the set that were real were those like in the, there was a, it was like desks on a rosette, you know, there was a column and all of these sort of trays coming out of it. If anyone remembers that.
Yep.
And then the trash can guy pops up in the script. The trash guy descends from the ceiling or something, I think. Anyway, when I looked at the still for that, it was just that, you know, that the thing with the trays and the column and nothing else. And when I looked at the production still, I could not imagine what that was. You know, I thought, is this his laboratory or is this the marketplace or, you know, what is this?
It's sitting out of context.
Yeah, I didn't get it at all. And when I saw the movie, like my eyes popped out. They were bigger than Alita's. I really was impressed with the, you know, with the production values and everything, because it was so good. It is a very good movie for being the kind of movie that it is, and it's, you know, it's like a science fiction adventure story, and you know, and the people are in situations that we can fairly easily identify with. You know, we can. I mean, they're, you know, it's like, no, none of us are, you know, cyborgs put into berserker bodies or, you know, kids playing motorball. We didn't grow up playing motorball or anything like that. But we can, you know, we can feel for the characters, we can identify with them, and we can appreciate the, you know, the action and the excitement and everything in it. And I think it's a wonderful movie for that kind of thing. It doesn't present itself as trying to be more than it is. It's you know, it does the job and it does it well.
You won't find any argument from us.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I guess I don't have to convince you guys it's a good movie.
Preaching to the choir. Yeah.
Pat, your wordsmith of the description of the scrapyard, a.k.a. Iron City, was amazing.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you very much. I'm glad to hear that.
And spoilers, there is a lot of, like you said, technology in the source material that is not in the movie or in your book. For instance, in Tefera, the floating city, there is suicide booths.
Yes. Yes. But I don't think that really fit with the tone that they were shooting for.
Well, yeah, especially also going through the PG-13.
Yeah.
Suicide booths are in the offshoot ending. They're not in the canon manga.
Hmm.
I think a part that got my interest was, it's maybe a more minor thing, but could be more to it. It was how also theory, as I've discussed a lot of it, and also, Sean O'Connell got to ask John Lander about it, but he was pretty crypty about that. It's basically that Alita is described as very heavy in several hundred pounds region. And I was like, how can Ito carry her as an old man? besides the fact that he is able to fight cyborgs at night and that should be stronger than him and faster. And I was theorizing maybe Edo is different. Maybe maybe Zalamites are stronger or genetically enhanced. Is there anything in that direction?
You know, that kind of went right by me. I did think of her as being, you know, a few hundred pounds. But when Hugo meets her and he helps her to her feet, you know, in the marketplace, he says, "Oh, you're heavy."
Yeah.
He blurts that out. He says, "Oh, oh, you're a cyborg," and that gets him out of that problem. But I thought of her as being fairly heavy, but not so heavy that it would be remarkable for a man in fighting fit condition to be able to carry her.
It's interesting because like the way that it's played out in the movie, like the fights in her instance, when she strikes as if she is extremely like way heavier than a usual person. And there are also few people have noticed that it looks very different the way she fights and the way she is usually acting. Because that kind of movements, physics that are behind it, that imply that she has a heavy weight. And then you have also that scene where she drops into the water and she just sinks in like a stone. So that's also a good indicator. And there's also a description in the making of books where just her core is described as being 300 pounds heavy. And this is like too much for an old man to do.
Yeah,
I think that's wrong.
I would say. You know, that's movie physics for you.
Yeah.
I was told that when I said, well, how high up is Zellum? They told me it was 5 miles up. You know, anything 5 miles up isn't going to be as easy to see as Zellum. So I just deliberately, I didn't even mention how high it was. Just, it's high, it's big. And
there's going to be a problem with breathable air 5 miles up,
yeah,
anyway.
Well, exactly. You know, it's like when you are up in the clouds, the air is thin. You know, it's like I've been in the Canadian Rockies, driving through the Canadian Rockies, and some of the areas of the Canadian Rockies are high enough that I remember we drove through something. I said, "Oh, look, fog," and they said, "That's not fog. That's a cloud, honey." And I thought, "Oh, no wonder I'm panting with, you know, breathless." And you know, there are all sorts of things. Movies just—if they were to be completely realistic, they wouldn't get to do half of what they do.
Mm-hmm.
You may have noticed that, like in TV shows and movies, people decide that they're going to go from New York to London or Germany. And they act like, you know, they get on the plane and a couple of hours later they're in New York or they're in London or Germany or something, you know. And, of course, it's not like that. But, you know, it's like people in movies and TV shows, they get there, you know, it's not 14 hours later, you know. They seem to get there almost immediately. We don't have the, you know, the Concorde anymore, so yeah. You can't blame it on the Concorde. movie physics, movie science, and movie time. It's not like, you know, it's not like ours.
I'm also I'm pretty aware that they try just to make it as good that it stands a surface glance, basically, that it doesn't fall apart just when you look at it. But of course, if you dig deeper, you will find inconsistencies. Like this example of the plane, you would see maybe if you think about harder, you would say, okay, 14 hours, then it would have, when they come at their destination, they would have, you would expect a certain daytime, like it would be night. And then you see, oh, it's day. So it's day when they board in and it's day when they board out. Something can't be right. So, but you have to dig more for that. Also, yeah. What is also interesting is basically in the movie, they seem to make sure to not show any kind of defensive abilities of the Alam. You just show they just showed the offensive abilities of the Erm. You saw their spaceships, you saw them firing, you saw their combat cyborgs, but you didn't see anything what Zalem has to offer to fight against that and how, or how they overcame that. That's also quite interesting.
Yeah, yeah, I noticed that too, but I think that was also something that a mystery that they wanted to encourage so that people would be intrigued, you know. It's like, people want to go to Zalem, but they never can get there. And how does Zalem repel itself when it doesn't have people like, you know, Vector to make sure that nobody gets there?
Yeah.
Yeah, or what would be the equivalent of, like, the border patrol or a border force?
Mm-hmm.
Well, in the manga, Zalem has an army of robots controlled by Deckman, basically. So, but we haven't seen much of any of them. There's the Netman. There's the combat units with the railguns and rocket launchers. There's a guy called Jay Onistay. If you have check him out on YouTube, he does a lot of really good analyses of the mangas. So if you're all curious about what people are thinking about these things, you can check that out.
And then of course there's the screwhead military people. Mm-hmm.
Socket soldiers.
Yeah.
But they were part of Barjack. So they're actually against Zalem. They're not part of Zalem's forces.
Well, looking at how Blackwater works, I'm pretty sure there's a supply line that Barjack got. Because remember, Barjack is kind of, you know, beneficially connected to Nova. So there might be some type of you know, secondary market there.
Who knows how many pies Nova has his fingers in, though. That's part of his mystery.
Well, one of the things that they didn't get into at all in the movie was the extreme personality change that Alita undergoes when she snaps into combat readiness, you know, her combat personality. In the script that I got, She knocks Gruishka, when she first meets Gruishka, she knocks him over the side of an elevated highway, and he falls into the darkness. Not, you know, he doesn't just jump into a dark hole like you see in, you know, in their original initial confrontation.
Yeah, that tracks more with the manga.
Yeah, well, she looks down, and she says, in another moment, he would have been mine. And then she snaps out of it, and she kind of comes back to herself, and she's thinking, oh, God, what did I do?
And I love that part.
Alita, okay. And that kind of went by the way, you know, in the movie. There was really no emphasis on that combat change, just when she flashbacks.
I wonder if they did that to, I guess, allow us to connect with Ido a little bit more, because obviously he was surprised when he discovered that this unknown cyborg that he rebuilt with his daughter's cyborg body all of a sudden started, you know, smashing face. And then all of a sudden she's like, oh, hi, Ido.
Well, it also would have taken more screen seconds to, you know, to see her go through that whole change of personality, change into, you know, lethal combat soldier, change out of it when it's all over. So I think it was simply for time considerations.
There was a lot of that. I mean, Rodriguez got the job of cutting back the script from 2.5 hours to 2 hours, and some things had to go.
Yeah.
We've calculated out that everything being equal, each second of the movie was about $138,000. So you can imagine that it would add up even if you added another 10 minutes to put, like, backstories in and things.
Yeah. What I remember is that the original script that Rodriguez was given was, like, 1,000 pages. So he had to go from 1,000 pages to 600.
No, there was 1,000 pages of notes. That wasn't the length of the original script. But he only got 600 pages of the notes sent to him by James Cameron.
I think it's kind of hinted that she snaps in and out of that combat mode by the first fight when she looked after Grishka and you saw the shock in her face, that she was surprised by herself that she did what she did.
Yeah.
That was the only hint we got about that.
Well, but also there's a little bit of it when she joins the motorball scrimmage and she hurts Tanji in the process of getting the motorball away from him and scoring. And it grew out of the fact that he full body checked her and grabbed the motorball and got away from her originally. So next time around in the scrimmage, she pays him back, a couple of years ago.
You see it in her face, that expression, like, I will get his ass, And then the second time, I remember it when they had tryouts, and they basically, she found out by Ido that they are about to kill her. And then you see her face snap from that friendly one into that, I will murder you all face.
Well, in the original script that I received, after Ido tells her that, she says, okay, good to know.
Yes, that line should have been in the movie, damn it. I read the book and I went, that really sums it up.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that one line, good to know. And I really wish that it would have been in the movie.
Yeah, I could see where they'd just splice that off for time. I should.
They made her face basically do all the talking in that moment.
Yeah, there's a lot of non-verbal storytelling, which I love. And I think a lot of people who complain about the movie just don't get.
Yeah, basically, there are a lot of people who just miss that she's a cyborg. They were like, why she's breathing, why she's eating and all that stuff. And they're like, it's all explained like several times.
A perfect example is Corso. Everybody knows, everybody here except Pat would know Corso, but she was going on Twitter just the other day about, it's like my X-th number of watch throughs, and I've just realized that Sheeran's reaction to seeing Alita for the first time is because that Alita's wearing her daughter's body, and I'm like, yeah. I kind of picked that one up on my first watch through. So I mean,
try to keep up, honey.
Yeah, different people realize things at different rates. So, but yeah, it's like, how many times did you have to watch that to pick that up?
It's also interesting to see that a lot of the story is also happening, of course, between the scenes. And if you don't like pay attention and just look at the scenes at face value, you will actually miss a part of the story. Like the time is passing, the characters, for example, like Shirin, how she appeared there at the church and all that thing. And you won't get it if you just don't think along the line, and you will say there's no chance she could appear there. But if you think along the movie, you will see, okay, she will have got instructions and all that stuff. You have to fill some gaps to make it plausible. Otherwise, of course, you would say there's no way she could know where Alia is and Hugo and why she's appearing there when she was 10 minutes before in the motorball area. So that's all the things.
Yeah, well, transitions like that are very easy to do in the movies. In the books, it's sometimes hard to do it smoothly enough that you don't stop the action or interrupt the action, but you have to still, you have to build that type of thing in. It belongs in the narrative. You can't simply say, okay, and then she jumped out the window, and then she got to Hugo. That's not good writing.
Well, speaking of good writing, congratulations on your Scribe Award for the novelization.
Thank you. Well, it's funny. I didn't even know there was a Scribe Award until I finished the book. And a bunch of us had gotten together for Christmas home office dinner, and a bunch of us writers get together every year for the home office Christmas party. And Paul Cornell is a writer, you're probably familiar with his name. He's done a lot of stuff for Doctor Who and Primeval, and, you know, I mean, he's like written scripts for TV and things, as well as novels. And he said, you want to have your editor send it in for the Scribe Awards. And I said, what are the Scribe Awards? And he told me, I said, there's an organization for writers of novelizations. And he said, yes. And he gave me the information on it. So, you know, and I emailed them and said, how do I join? And they said, okay, you're in. And then they explained how to, you know, how to submit the book. And then the date for the movie had, you know, was I think it was moved back twice, first from July to December, and then to February of the following year. And meanwhile, you know, it's like Iron City had already come out, and I thought, well, at least Iron City isn't set after Alita Battle Angel. So, you know, that works. It's okay. And but the novelization, of course, didn't come out until the movie came out. And the movie came out, and I asked books if they would please send all the, you know, the judges of the appropriate category books, because I was financially challenged. And so they agreed to do it. And I guess you have to tell them that you want to be considered for the award. And I was, you know, I was tickled to be nominated, and I, you know, I thought that was wonderful. And I've been working on another project right now for Titan. And the day that the awards were announced, I lost track of the days, and I woke up the next morning, and I, you know, I looked at the date, and I thought, oh, the Scribe Awards were announced yesterday. Gee, I wonder who won. I was so thrilled to win that. You know, that was really nice.
It is well deserved.
Well, thank you.
And Didn't the cover win an award as well?
Pardon?
Didn't the cover win an award as well?
I think so. Don't quote me because I'm not sure. But the person who did the cover also did another cover for another one of the books of the nominated works, and you know, she did a beautiful job, and I have no sense of design myself, so but I can see, you know, angles and lines and things. I think very visually, and although I can't draw a straight line, I can see when a line isn't straight, when it's off plumb. And but that's not all there is to design, of course. There's, you know, but I love the cover of Alita, and I really love the design of the book. For those of you who haven't seen the physical book itself, which I don't think it's anybody here actually,
probably
in the book. You've seen the gorgeous designs in between the chapters and the chapter headings, and those are all the designs that I was given, that they said would be adorning her first body, the little girl body.
Oh. I'll be honest, some of that scroll work I'm actually considering getting tattooed on me.
You're not the only one.
I feel like I'm old school in the sense that I couldn't wait to have the hardback sent in, and I'm a fanatic when it comes to hardbacks over paperbacks, but I couldn't wait for them to be ordered in because all the local bookstores had them listed as out of stock and they'd have to get them in from the warehouse and whatnot. Mm-hmm. That I did order, like, not only did I have that coming in, but I also paid and ordered for the e-books as well. Like I said, I couldn't wait. I didn't even bother buying an e-book reader. I just got them on my iPhone.
The designs are in there, you know, in the e-book versions.
Oh, cool.
And Yeah, but like I said, for me, it's, I don't know, something about having the physical book in my hand and like the feel of the cover, the paper, and this might get a little bit weird, but the smell of the paper as well.
David,
everybody smells the books. All book lovers smell their books. We love
new book smellers, yes. Like new car smell.
Yep.
You guys, I get too happy with my books sometimes.
Does anybody appreciate old book smell?
Yes.
Been in libraries for a long time. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Completely different. Oh, yeah. The smell of age of a text.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Okay.
Now we're getting completely off track. There was an interesting question from the chat, and maybe you can shed some light on it, Pat, but maybe you can't because it's a bit complicated. But when she's playing motorball, and I must say that I really enjoy your description of how she plays motorball, like some of the comments like, I call this one taking it to the streets. I chuckled when I read that. But there's a section in there where she...
I think that was the original script, actually.
Oh, right. Okay. Because it's something she thinks. She doesn't say it. So I don't know how it would have translated to the screen.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe, you know, I got so immersed in the script that it's hard for me now to tell, you know, where a lot of things left off and where I, you know, maybe I did like that.
Yeah. I attributed that to you because it's something she thinks, so it would not have appeared verbally.
Okay. Yeah, maybe.
But that particular scene where she's talking to Hugo, she's lost her helmet because one of the other cyborgs has cut it off her. But she hasn't got a helmet on yet. She's having a phone conversation without having any phone in her hand or anything.
Well, the problem is that, and I you can blame me for this, I never did figure out how to mention that Ito had built a phone into her head.
That's what we figured had happened.
But it's not a telepresence chip. It's something different, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure what it is, but she had a phone like everybody else. If it wasn't in the helmet, it's part of her head. You know,
well, it's every teenage girl's dream to have a phone in their head, so you were just doing them a favor.
Ever did get around to I kept making mental notes. The guy mentioned how he does that, and I could never find a place to sort of gracefully put the mention in. And then in the end, but then the movie doesn't either. So
no. There's just some assumed stuff that you just have to take it. But that's answered one question, so there you go.
It's also interesting. One point is the first thing what I noticed when I read the Iron City book was that is a lot more cursing, even from Alita, but also from Ito, which I didn't expect. I watched the movie. And Ito is like a gentleman, he never curses or anything. Or I probably didn't even think in curses, but in the book he did. And later when I saw in the Blu-ray specials, there's also a part about the original 2005 Cameron version that was like a little bit animated. And it was actually there. So it was really interesting to see also the shift in tone, we could say. Also, the graphics went a lot more brighter from the original drawings you saw. Yeah, that was a really interesting part.
Well, in Iron City, the loss of his daughter is still much fresher for him. And Shiren has only just left him. So he's not taking things very well, and he doesn't have his daughter around to be a good example for, and now his wife has left him. So you know, he's
still very raw.
He's still he's still very wounded, and he hasn't really, you know, started to recover yet.
I see. And also another fact that I found interesting is also, I mean, even from the movie, you can get it that if Nova wanted to do so, he could have basically destroyed Alita at several different occasions, but it seems not to be his plan with her. It seems to toy with her and tries to drive her to a specific direction, like he did in the manga. I think it's also a good a theme that they are following for the movie, but they don't explain it as much. So it's more hinted.
Well, with someone like Nova, you know, you have the watcher behind the eyes, where he likes to ride different people. In fact, that's how Shiren first talks about him. She mentions the telepresence chip in Grishka's head. She says someone's riding him, and it's just absolutely revolted by this. And someone who does that isn't someone who's, you know, straightforward about destroying you. You know, they just don't, they don't just kill you with a thunderbolt. They toy with you and toy with you and toy with you until you just have no more fun for them, sadistic fun left in you. And then they just toss you on the scrap heap.
Well, she got tossed on the scrap heap first, and then yeah. He had the fun.
Yeah, well, yes, I don't, you know, he thought it was over, but it isn't, you know, and he was surprised to find out that he can't have his way with, you know, just everybody.
But that becomes a challenge. He's probably looking for challenges.
Maybe, but I don't think that he really likes someone fighting back as successfully as she does.
To borrow a line from the movie Gladiator, basically they said to destroy Maximus, they have to first destroy his character. Mm-hmm. Hearing all this makes me think that maybe that's, if he does want to destroy a leader, then maybe he does want to not just destroy the body, but the spirit and the name of Alita, or anyone even associated with her. Mm-hmm. Which also leads to when Vector says, like when she says, you know, I don't need your permission to live, and then, you know, maybe yeah. not, but others might. Oh, yeah. It just blows my mind.
Yeah, that gave me chills, because, and it's also an illustration of how fundamentally innocent she is, you know, where I don't need your permission to live, and she doesn't realize at that point that he will, if he can't get at her directly, he will get at her through who and what she loves. Mm. And that hasn't occurred to her because, you know, she's not that kind of person.
I suspect in her past she hasn't had many people that have been attached to her like that.
Well, you know, you see hints in the training that she's undergoing. And in the training flashback in the book, the description of her fighting a boy, that was how it was in the script as it was given. And they changed it fairly late, I guess, in the production to her training with Gerda. But people who are, you know, are trained like that, are trained to think of themselves as solitary. To beat me, you have to beat me. No, they think of themselves as soldiers who are, you know, in combat, not as people are connected to other people. You know, that's not a soldier. That's a member of a community.
It's also, while speaking about the sadism that Nova experienced, expresses its... It aligns a lot with the sadism we see in the manga, but I think there's also the interesting difference that in the manga he has a bit more an ulterior move behind that. He has a sadistic nature too, and he likes to play with people and toy them, but also sense that he wants to push Alita to a specific point because he's also interested in karma and all that things. And it feels like for me like he's looking for an answer, maybe how to break karma or how to change destiny and all that stuff. And he's obsessed with that. And I wonder if something like that is also coming with the movie Nova in any shape or form.
Well, once again, you know, they didn't show much of Nova.
Mm.
You know, just a few tantalizing glimpses. And they didn't even, Ed Norton is uncredited in the role, such as, if you can call it a role. It's, you know, it's a cameo, non-speaking appearance. And the fact that they had chosen Ed Norton for it seemed to suggest to me that at that time they were thinking very much in terms of more movies, a series of movies, because they, you know, they wanted to tantalize you with the possibility of seeing Ed Norton, you know.
You haven't heard the story about that?
I have no story about it. You know.
Ah, well, I can fill that one in. So Ed Norton wanted to, well, it's been reported, so I've read about it because I read about everything to do with this. But Ed Norton wanted to do something with James Cameron. And now I got this back the front the last time, so I've got to make sure I get this right. Ed said, oh, have you got a spot for me in your Avatar sequels? And James said, the only people we haven't cast are humans. He says, oh, no, I want to be a Na'vi. And he said, oh, well, they're all cast at the moment, so we don't have anything there. He said, have you got anything else? He said, Rodriguez is making the Alita movie finally, and we haven't got anybody to play Nova yet. There's not much to it, but, you know, if it takes off, there'll be some serious sort of screen time in sequels. And he said, oh, yeah, I'll give that a go. And that's how he ended up being Nova.
Well, what I figured was, you know, it's like in my experience, they give you a glimpse of someone to get you to, you know, get you to anticipate a return and a bigger glimpse. You know, it's like it will, you know, flesh out into something big, which is why I thought, you know, it's like, well, I guess they are going to do some sequel.
Well, they said they did want to do sequels, but Jim Cameron said that they would let the audience decide, which basically meant if it made a lot of money, there'd be sequels on the way. But then, of course, there's the whole merger thing and the fact that it's now under Disney at this stage, and Disney working on the properties that they have direct control over. So they just parked it, as far as we can tell.
Yeah. Well, it happens. But also there's what I call Hollywood ADHD. They'll get very excited about something. And with many things, you'll be lucky if their excitement lasts 5 weeks or even 5 days. I remember years ago when The Sparrow by Mary Doria Russell came out. Hollywood jumped on that, and they were actually calling her up, and she was talking about how she had talked to Antonio Banderas, was going to play the priest, and then suddenly nothing, you know, not even crickets, and they all got, you know, they all got high on the idea and they loved the idea and, you know, they were going to make the movie and it was going to be great. And somebody got distracted by something shiny and they all, I've seen this happen. You know, I've had friends who have had, you know, some kinds of big deal in the offing where, you know, it's like they're going to get this very lucrative option deal and it was going to develop into something and then it was going to develop and develop and develop and the option fell through because whoever was going to option it just sort of wandered away, you know, or the director who was going to get attached to it got distracted by something shiny. You know, this happens so often in Hollywood. You could not pay me enough to work in Hollywood.
Yeah, we've had discussions on the stream about Hollywood accounting. Like, they never actually tell you if a movie's made money or not, unless it's blindingly obvious. Like, anything that costs $250 million to make and makes $1 billion has obviously made money. But Alita being on the cusp of did it or didn't it, we presume it did, because if you read about what Rodriguez was saying about it, what it actually ended up costing was $150 million because he got some grants from New Zealand, which came in later. So everybody quotes the actual cost of film it was $200 million. With tax credits, they got down to $170 million. But Rodriguez is actually on record for saying it cost in the realm of $150 to make. So if you look at that and you look at double the cost for advertising, which it wouldn't have cost because the advertising group who did the advertising were actually busy getting new jobs because Fox was going under. They didn't actually do a very good job of advertising, especially US domestically. So I don't think they spent another $150 million on advertising, but the fact that it made $404 million worldwide, and, of course, a lot of that was in China, which they don't get as much from per ticket sale as domestically, you've got to try and guesstimate how much they actually took in. But there's been about $60 million in Blu-ray sales. I think Charles Smith's one of our numbers guys, and I think that was the number he was suggesting. So I think in the end it has made money, but not a staggering enough amount to instantly guarantee a sequel. But then, of course, there's the whole issue of IP control, which Disney is big on. So that's probably what's holding it up more than anything.
Yeah, well, I don't think anyone who was involved in the making of Alita is on food stamps.
No.
And I've seen movies that have really tanked, and Alita did not tank.
You know, amen.
So I would say that it's a success, certainly, but it's disheartening to find that people are still, they don't just want a success, they want a success, you know.
Yes, everything's going to be massive.
They want something so impossible that, you know, it can't possibly happen, so nothing's ever a success.
Well, it's a new IP. I mean, the first time you roll something out, first version of a car, the first movie in a franchise, they don't do as big as, you know, things that follow up when people have really got a feel for it. We as the Alita Army have seen so many people come on Twitter and go, oh, my God, how did I miss this in the cinema? It's so good. And the fandom is growing every day. I mean, every single day, every time it's on HBO, there's more people who see it. There's more people who go, oh, my God, this world is great. We want more.
Well, my advice is, Alita Army, write the studio, you know, write Disney, write 20th Century Fox, write, you know, and I mean, I don't mean just email, you know, it's like get a physical piece of paper, write on it, fold it in an envelope and send it, you know, to the studio.
Yeah.
I don't know if that will actually do any good. But they can't delete it the way they can an email.
Yeah, at least we can try that. And also when we're speaking about the box office, like, I think a situation that was pretty similar was when the Batman trilogy in the 2000s came out with Batman Begins. That movie made like $400 million, same like Alita. And comic book movies were at a bad spot back then. Marvel was already, at the cusp of bankruptcy. DC didn't do too hot. Comics were sales were not so big. And people had a lot of distrust against the Batman movies because the last, before the Batman begins, was bad or not as well received. And they trusted simply the process and went ahead with a sequel, and that one brought $1 billion and was a huge success. And overall, the whole trilogy was a big success because they put the trust into that IP and just went out with that, even though it wasn't like back then you couldn't have seen it in advance that it would blow up like that. So, yeah. And they wouldn't need to do the same with Alita. They had a good start. It made its money back. They did a bit of plus with the Blu-rays, and it's easy to see that this movie will at least make double the money on the second run. So,
yeah,
I have something to add to that. The
difference between Batman Begins and Alita: Battle Angel. Batman Begins made $205 million at the domestic North American market, and Alita basically made $85 million, so there's a slight difference. Even though Alita made a worldwide total that's better than Batman Begins, it has the same potential for a trilogy or a whole franchise. But maybe investors set their priorities differently. I'm not sure. I have no idea. But you have to keep that in mind.
Yes. And speaking of that, it is especially the national national box office that would have the highest growth rate in the sequel, most likely, because we knew Alita underperformed for the first movie in America, North America. It would have done a lot better in a different circumstances. So I see a lot more potential for it bring at least
million
or 200 exactly. million domestically. So.
Well, the domestic breakpoint for a guaranteed sequel is supposed to be 100 million at the box office.
Easy. Next time will be easy.
I think that with the groundswell of interest from the first movie on streaming, would definitely break 100 million domestically. But we've got to actually convince them to back it. And of course, with the pandemic and the cinema's been shut down, it's all just talk about movies until we know when the domestic market will be able to open cinemas and make money there again.
So I think we have to trust that basically when even the movie would produce today, if it would start today, it would need at least 2 to 3 years until it's finally out. And they have to trust that in 3 years, the situation would be a whole different story. So.
Oh, we'll make sure they won't forget.
In the past month, we've had Snyder Cut announced. We've had Tron 3 announced. Just yesterday, now this wouldn't affect a lot of you guys, but it certainly affects me, is The Dragon Prince on Netflix, which is a fantastic series. I recommend anybody who likes a really well-told story to watch that one. It's been renewed for 4 more seasons by Netflix. It took them 1.5 years to decide. But they've renewed it for 4 seasons, and that's because that's the next block of the story. The story was 3 seasons, and then it sort of ends, and then the next block is 4. So they've decided we're telling the whole next sector of the story, which is great. So I'm looking forward to that. But, I'm just waiting for my most favorite and last one to be announced. We've had this sort of roll-on of good things.
To expand on what you said too, I think I remember reading somewhere that traditionally, quote unquote, Netflix only prefers to do like 3 to 4 seasons or something before moving on. So to have something to go on any longer than that would have to be a pretty solid success.
Well, it's done by the same guys who did Last Airbender.
Well, they must have learned from their last lesson.
Not the movie, the series.
Oh, okay.
Don't look at that movie. Alita is the only actual proper conversion from anime / manga.
Speaking of adaptations, two, and before I forget the even titles of them, Predator and The Crow. Now, The Crow was adapted from a graphic novel by James O'Barr. And the first one gained a huge cult following that probably still exists to this day. And they made, like, God knows how many god-awful sequels to the point where, you know, much like most other fandoms, they only really ever look at the first one as the thing. But the fact that they made so many more sequels and yet not for Alita, that boggles my mind. Moving on to The Predator, almost a similar thing. The first two movies are really, really good. But you move on to AVP, you move on to the other Predator remakes, which look like they had pretty high budgets themselves, and they did nowhere near as well as the first two movies. And yet they still made them. but they won't greenlight Alita. And again, that just sort of makes me want to bang my head against the wall in asking why.
Rob Rodriguez said that Alita was the most expensive indie movie ever made, because it wasn't made in Hollywood. It was made in Austin, Texas, and New Zealand. Those were the two main places where the work was done. And, it just basically kept away from the Hollywood sort of its own pandemic of wokeness and did things its own way and relied on storytelling, not politics. And that's probably part of the reason it wasn't so well received back in California. So that could be another reason that it's not getting the love that it deserves.
Or how it didn't do as well locally as it did internationally, because obviously internationally you've got a more wider array of cultures and approaches to PC and so forth. But
I think also a big reason is simply the fact it's a cyberpunk, and second, it has thankfully the touch of weird, what is typical for anime. In that movie, it's basically a live action anime movie, and it's weird. You know, people were weirded out at first, and they needed some time to get used to that look and feel, because it's completely different from things that you usually see. And it's not just different; it's also good by being different. And that is the thing they didn't expect. They thought, okay, it would be weird and different, but not good, weird, different.
It's gonzo. It's not so much weird. It's what I call gonzo, which is a bit crazy cool.
Yeah. You know, guys, I hate to do this, but Grandma, it's past Grandma's bedtime. And the little old lady is going to have to beg off now. I think it's been almost 2 hours.
Could you give us 5 more minutes for a couple of questions that people have posed?
Sure. Sure, no problem.
Terrific. Well, we'll jump straight into the questions. So Liam, who's had to drop off the call because his internet was playing up, has asked, Pat, if you had a chance to write the sequel books, what story points would you personally want to use? So from the manga, I'm presuming he's saying.
Wow. If I had a chance to write, it would be entirely up to the studio. You know, the whatever they would do would be whatever I would, you know, I would write about. You don't really have a whole lot of discretion in terms of things that that you may want to emphasize personally. You know, when I mentioned that, you know, it's like they wanted me to write a real book, they didn't mean that I could take any liberties with the plot or with the kind of people the characters were. But so the things that, you know, I'm trying to imagine what they would do, you know, for you know, Alita's next story. And I would imagine that it would have to be some kind of crisis with Zalem.
It looks like that's what they're angling for.
You know, that's what it seems to me anyway. So any other questions?
I've got one for you from reading the prequel novel. Obviously, Vector's out of the picture, which is quite a change from the manga. He doesn't die in the manga at all. He gets disabled, but he's there right up until the end of the original series. But obviously, he's gone already in the end of the first movie. So they've obviously got to come up with a replacement to run the factory. And I get the feeling from the prequel novel that you've foreshadowed that pretty effectively with the Duchess. Do you get the feeling that that's what they were intending with that?
I've done what with it?
The character of the Duchess, the drug dealer who Hugo talks to on the steps of the church when he's getting his bracelet back from his mother.
Yeah. Well, I figured that, you know, I had known going into Iron City, I knew that that Vector was going to meet his end. And I was thinking that, you know, it's like, what, even while he was still around controlling things, there are always people who are simmering, you know, simmering on the back burner, looking to see how they can, fit in or have a chance to get their foot in the door to be the next Mr. Big or Ms. Big. And, I guess I was kind of thinking that. I just knew that I needed someone other than Vector, or someone who worked with Vector, and the Duchess was that, but also to give the idea that there are more things going on in the city. Iron City is it's a pretty big place, and Vector can't be everywhere at once.
Exactly. He's got his underlings, but he can't be personally in control. And his character was a character who wanted to be personally in control of absolutely everything. He was very micromanagey.
Yeah.
There was one other thing about the books that differed from, I don't know if you've seen it, the extra features from the DVD release or the Blu-ray release. Mm-hmm. They have a section in there that talks about the different sectors of the city, and they give them all different names, like Bureau, Centralis, and all this sort of stuff. I can't remember them exactly off the top of my head, but it's very sort of Spanish sort of names. Whereas in your, especially the prequel novel, you talk about Northland and Southland and Midtown and Southie, but that really doesn't track with what they put in the extended features.
Well, none of the stuff from the extended features, you know, the names for the different areas of the city, were in the script at all. I didn't know that they had any names for different areas of the city, or that they were even acknowledging that that Iron City was so big that there would be different parts of it. The fact is, the original manga is the general Kansas City area.
Yep.
And that's why they have the Kansas bar. Although, you know, it's like, I quibble with that. Someone from Kansas City, partly from Kansas City, they'd have called it the Kansas City bar or the KC bar or something. Because people from, even those people who live on the Kansas side of the state line in the Kansas City area, don't speak of themselves as being from Kansas. They say I'm from Kansas City. And Kansas City is, for those who may not know, it's the state line between Missouri and Kansas runs right up the middle. And so there's Kansas City, Missouri, and there's Kansas City, Kansas. They're two different cities completely. And most of the time when you hear about things going on in Kansas City, you're hearing about things in Kansas City, Missouri. Anyway, there's a little bit of trivia for you. Kansas City, of course, has a very large Hispanic population. And I was told that the setting for the movie would be, they wouldn't explicitly say that this was what we once knew as Kansas City, but that the characters would be more Hispanic then they would be, Asian.
The basis of that is that James Cameron's very big on physics and mm-hmm. things sort of working rather than obviously being not working. Now, the physics for a space elevator and a city floating, it's got to do with the spin of the city at the top holding up the city at the bottom. Mm-hmm. And that only works at the equator. If you're off the equator, you get sort of eddies and off spins and stuff, and it would end up crashing. Mm-hmm. So basically James Cameron said, it has to be at the equator or close to the equator so that it's actually physically possible. And they've suggested it as Panama City, but they've never explicitly stated it. So that's why it went Hispanic. And that kind of worked for Rob Rodriguez as well, because being Hispanic, he can work with that better.
Yeah, but also the truth is there is a large Hispanic population in Kansas City. You are more likely to meet Spanish-speaking people than you are to meet French-speaking people.
There is actually... go ahead.
You meet anybody else, you know, actually, Kansas City is, it's a very interesting cultural place. Every year prior to the pandemic, when the South by Southwest Festival would happen in Austin, bands going down to play at South by Southwest would stop on their way in Kansas City and they'd do gigs there. I saw a lot of great bands, you know, before anyone at South by Southwest got to see them. And I didn't have to pay half what they've had to pay. So Kansas City is also this incredible food town. And
barbecue is great.
Well, it's not just barbecue. There's also a large Vietnamese population, or there was when I was living there. And so there's lots of Asian foods and just all kinds of wonderful things. And I loved Kansas City. I loved living there. And although I was actually born in New York and I grew up in Massachusetts, but I spent most of my adult life in the Kansas City area up until 1996 when I moved to London.
I was going to say Kansas City is extremely diverse. That's one thing that you notice with the manga is the fact that there's a lot of black characters, a lot of I guess you can call them Hispanic. I mean, I don't know what Josh Gunn would be, but he does have tan skin. I've always seen him as someone who tanned, but I think that Kishiro was really trying to channel that in his adaptation of what Kansas City would be like, you know, trying to channel the diversity.
It is a very diverse city. And it's considering that it's actually in the middle of the American Bible Belt, it's quite an amazing oasis of tolerance, because people in Kansas City know that if every gay person in town suddenly packed up and left, there'd be nothing left in the middle of Kansas City but a big hole and maybe a standpipe. And this can sound like stereotyping, but I used to work for Hallmark Cards, which was the big company in Kansas City, and they hired hundreds and hundreds of artists, many of whom happened to be gay. And so a lot of gay-owned businesses grew up around, you know, the employees at Hallmark. And some of the artist employees went off on their own, started their own graphic arts businesses, or did freelance work. So Kansas City is a good place to feel at home, no matter what flavor you are.
That's terrific. So, Cranberry, you've been keeping track of the chat questions. Is there any there that jump out at you that we should get Pat to answer before she heads off to have a good night's rest?
The biggest one I see is someone said they really loved when you noted in the novel on the first page, Battle Angels Live Forever. Was that something you put in personally or something from the script?
Oh, no, that's a personal thing. The three names of Susan Casper, Georgina, and Jerry, none of them were sick when I was diagnosed with terminal cancer. And all of them died within like 2 years of each other. And I was really devastated. Susan was, you know, one of my closest and longest standing friends. And Georgina, I'd gotten to know because she was the wife of a writer friend of mine. And she was, you know, she was really lovable and sweet. And she died shortly after her 50th birthday of breast cancer. And it was so awfully, awfully unfair. And Jerry was taken very, very suddenly. She developed an infection and went to the emergency room. And then she went very quickly. And I was devastated at losing all of them so close together. And so when I came back from... I'd gone to America to Susan's memorial service. When I came back the same day, I had to go to Georgina's funeral, and it was hard losing them. And I felt that, you know, all three of these women were very strong women. They were very feisty, and they're, you know, they're full of life. And I loved them all very much. And when I got the assignment for Battle Angel, it was the first thing I thought of was, you know, to dedicate it to their memories and to say Battle Angels live forever. And that was something that I said.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Would have never expected that. That's the story that is behind that.
Life is precious.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Just ask me.
Remember, you've got a question here in the show notes. For Pat, is how do you feel you've developed as an author over the years, both good and bad?
Oh, well, bad, I don't want to talk about.
Sounds right.
Yeah. You know, I occasionally teach writing workshops, and I tell the students that it's great to have talent, but talent is a very, very small part of everything. Talent is a muscle, and it can be developed. And the thing about writing is the more you do it, the better you get at it. Now, you might not necessarily become a great writer or even a good writer, but if you keep going, you become a better writer. And when I started out, I was nothing special, you know. No one said, oh, that looks like Pat Cadigan in development over there. I didn't attract attention until I'd been at it for a while. And then I found myself, you know, I was getting the hang of this. And occasionally I'd write something, and I'd think, wow, I sound like a real writer. And, but, you know, it's like you don't hang around being impressed with yourself. You just keep going. And I was fortunate enough that early on in my career, I met Ellen Datlow, who at that time was the fiction editor at Omni magazine. And Ellen taught me everything I know, practically everything I know about good writing. And it's really because of her that whatever's good about my work, I learned by writing for her. And that's the one thing that I, you know, that I wish for all writers is that they meet a good editor, you know. And if it's not an editor, at least someone that you show your work to who can, you know, tell you what you need to know about it. But I was very fortunate that I met Ellen, and she shaped my work for the most part. Bad, I just don't want to talk about.
Fair enough. Cranberry, do you have any more questions from the audience, as it were?
Or perhaps yourself?
I don't want to keep Pat any longer if she needs to go.
Hey, I've always got time for one more question. And if you have no more questions, that's okay too. You're not obligated.
Oh, I've actually still got a page of questions, but I don't want to keep you up till dawn.
I would. Do you have questions for us?
It's been amazing hearing your insights.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
Pat, do you have basic questions maybe for us?
You know, if I do, they went to bed. you know, I'm not as alert, you know, as I was a couple of hours ago.
No, fair enough.
Maybe next time I come back, I'll start with questions for you, and then I'll, you know.
That would be great.
Yay!
That would be much obliged, yeah.
I have got one here from John Lutz. He says, why are the Erm soldiers' eye sockets enlarged, and are the non-militant citizens of Mars big-eyed too? I'm presuming this is the skulls in the ship when Alita goes in to get the body.
They are big-eyed because that's what it said in the script. I have no idea if this is, you know, a style or a requirement on ERM or what, but, you know, it's like I write what I see, so to speak, and this is the information that I was given, and I thought, well, you know, not everything can be explained. Let them wonder.
Well, sunlight isn't exactly as bright on Mars as on Earth. That would be something, I think.
Yeah,
about.
Yeah. There's a whole lot of physics reasons. Yeah,
yeah, there are all kinds of reasons.
But we never know.
Nope.
Cranberry, do you want to ask your question about nods to the manga?
Just real quick. When I was reading the novel, and it might just... that maybe I was reading into it too much, but I felt like there was a couple little sprinkles in there from the manga. I'm not sure if it's from the script or from you, Pat, having read the manga, specifically the butterfly landing on the hand and Spike. Well, oh, go ahead.
That was the butterfly on the hand was in the script.
Okay. The other one being where you put in the prequel, perhaps that's where humanity was going now, brains and boxes, ghosts and machines. Considering that you haven't read all the manga, that's actually a pretty good nod to Last Order. And
yeah, I don't think I've read that one. And it's probably, you know, sort of a subliminal memory of what I had read with my son many years ago. But I did review a lot of the manga, but I didn't review that much because there's an awful lot of it.
Yeah.
And I knew that the movie wasn't going to cover, you know, all of those books. So I figured I'd just, you know, I'd just refresh my memory. And at least I had something to think about and something to immerse myself in before I got the actual script.
Okay, because when I read that line, I was just like, oh, that's so clever. Such a nod.
Oh, happy accidents. I love them.
That's awesome.
Well, thank you very much for coming on, Pat. We know that you've had a few struggles with health recently, so we really appreciate your time late at night there in England. And
thank you for inviting me. It's really been a pleasure.
Know that if you want a sequel, you are part of the Alita Army, and therefore this channel is for you, so you're welcome back anytime. Just let us know, and we'll fit you into the show.
Well, thank you very much. And I imagine there's a return engagement.
Thank you, Pat, for your insights.
Well, thank you very much, and I hope to talk to all of you again in the not-too-distant future.
That would be terrific.
Before Exploding City, certainly.
Uh-huh. Thank you. A little while yet.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pat.
Good night. Thank you.
Good night, bye-bye. Pat.
See you.
Night.
Bye-bye. Good night.
And there she goes. Well, wasn't that exciting?
Was great.
Yeah.
Oh, I can breathe now and like not have to be like try to control myself and nerding out and like I said, the only other time that's ever happened to me is when I met, funnily enough, another favorite author of mine. Her name was Sarah J. Maas, and I met her and got her to sign my books at a convention.
Is this Tom?
And big one.
Throne of Glass.
Tog, yes. I think I might have even mentioned it somewhere. But yeah, like I said, I sort of had to almost hold my breath to not just completely lose control and
Just remember that not everybody who's famous is also a person. Treat them like a person, it's all good.
Yeah.
So we haven't done news yet. We kind of got into our main topic, but there has been a crap ton of stuff this week. Obviously, the big one was our Twitter trending. I believe the last shot I saw of that was from Charles Smith, who's in the text chat there. 16,700, I think it was 16,700 tweets in about 8 hours. Does anybody have any clarification or update on that one? Yes, no, maybe. Nope, I'm taking that as a note. So we'll go with Reddit as that. It was about 16,700 tweets in 8 hours. We did trend. We were trending by 5,000. So that was pretty fantastic. Does anybody have anything they'd like to add about how that went?
That felt so surreal. With Denny, with you guys, Radio Chaos, and just Alita Army in general, like, this is my first sort of, without being too disrespectful, it popped my cherry in terms of streaming and whatnot, and that was my first time trending on Twitter or being involved in it, and it was just such an experience.
Cool banana. So during that trending was when we got some more people into the Twitter poll against Little Women. Now, I know that you've been focused pretty heavily on that, Dave. Do you want to run through how that went?
Well, throughout all the rounds that we've had, as pretty much the whole army would know, Parasite has been the only one to ever beat us. And that was so close, even with nearly 40,000 votes, they only beat us by even less than 1%. So it was like, 49.8 to 50.2 or something like that. Every other one has always been like a difference of like 10 to 20%. And once we got the lead, we never lost it. Until when Little Women came along. Now, they got the early lead, like pretty much mostly they always do. And then once the Alita Army woke up and we started tweeting, it's like, bang, we took it. And we had a pretty commanding lead. But once it started to, the time zone changed and it started to dip off, Little Women really sort of took that opportunity, and we actually lost the lead for the first time. And I think it got as low as like 42% for a leader. And I sort of expected that and mentally and emotionally prepared myself for the defeat. Because we knew, but that wasn't a bad thing, because I wanted to be more focused on making a leader trend, because that was the real mission. But it had that, I guess, the dual effect of, if we did just throw in the link to it in our tweets, much like we would attach a GIF or a picture, a meme, that, like, it'd just bring more attention. And if we just stayed positive, stayed true to being leader advocates, then that we'd sort of at least get closer, if not just edge out and retake that lead. I just didn't expect to retake that lead by such a huge amount in such a short time, because we jumped from 42% to 58% or something like that. And it only ever dropped down to like 54 or 55 before time ran out. So that was, that blew my mind.
Does anybody else have a reaction to how the Twitter trending went?
I think it went pretty well, I would say, as a whole. And also, what I'm recognized is that the tweets were pretty much high quality, that Charlie also recognized and talked about. And I think the overall outcome was, I think the best thing was the Vice article that came out at the end. I didn't expect something like that, especially when you read the title and then expect that they knock you down, and it was a really, really wholesome article that was written about it, about us, and I was basically flattered to read that. And that person seems to be as a writer seems to be a hard advocate of Alita, which was also interesting to have one of those with Vice.
Which article was that? Because there was a number of them.
There's one Vice article. Yes, so yeah. Army is rampaging through. And this person, Jita Jackson, she had a lot of talks in the recent days with fans of her. I'm not sure on Twitter, and she's ferociously defending Alita, so which is pretty interesting. So
I like the way she summed it up in saying that the woman who was the director for Little Women, who is going on to bigger and better things, is going to be producing more stuff, and it'll be in that sort of a vein. I mean, Little Women, I don't know that it has a sequel written, but she'll be doing more of that sort of, dare I say it without getting slapped down, chick flick kind of story. But this writer, Gita, was saying that we're still out in the cold and we should have the opportunity to win the poll and get more attention so that we have a chance to go on and get more of our our story told. So I really liked the way she put that forward as, well, these guys are deserving too. You don't have to win because you're already winning.
Little Women is already highly acclaimed around not just film Twitter, but is 6 times Oscar nominated and won one of those Oscars. I think it got its fair share, and she will continue to get shares in the movie industry while Alita's future, as you said, is completely undecided. So she wanted to have us the stage for at least once. So,
yeah, I thought that was very nice of her to phrase it like that. That's quite a reasonable argument as well.
And I think the Cinema Blend article today is kind of feels like a reaction to the sequel push, because the sequel push was basically coined towards Paramount, and you could see or read in the article that it was basically really saying that Alita is more it's basically Fox's and now Disney's, and so it wouldn't be easy to just go over to another studio and just do it something like that, you know. I'm not sure if you read the complete article.
I haven't had an opportunity because, like, this stream starts 7 a.m. Sunday morning my time, so I haven't been reading anything while I'm asleep.
Yeah. So I think it's very interesting because there are, like, 2 or 3 direct quotes from Robert Rodriguez regarding the situation, how they managed to get the first one green-lighted, and also regarding to who owns Alita. But I'm not sure if that is like the whole picture that he covered there, or if it's just distribution factor that he's talking about. It's still, for me, not really clear. So, but it looks, if you follow his words, it looks like as if Disney would now entirely possess Alita, which would be a big roadblock for anything going forward.
It would. I mean, we've always been told that the Alita movie IP was firmly in the hands of James Cameron. If that's not the case, then it changes the roadmap considerably.
Yeah, also, this
could be a reaction to our Twitter push towards Paramount as well.
I think that's interesting. It's really, if it's really like some kind of information they are giving us, then it's basically good to know and really, really important information. If it's like, he can only give it indirectly. He cannot directly say, yeah, it's like that and that, and here is a contract that will explain you everything. I can't do that, but it's basically the most very direct, because it's such a short time after the push, so I feel like it's directed towards that.
Could be, yeah. Anybody else got any comments on those ones?
I guess the sheer amount of positive articles and positive media, considering that we had so much media bashing on us for to begin with. And by us, I don't just mean the Alita and the IP, but us as the hashtag Alita Army as well. the fact that we're not just sort of changing eyes, but I guess changing hearts as well, little by little.
Yeah, every day, little by little, one by one. That's what we're here for, nothing else.
Every avalanche starts with the first rolling stone.
Yeah.
So Starvelian has poked me and said that it was Rose's birthday. So everybody saw that one?
What, tweet?
Yeah. Yeah, there was some fantastic art done for Rose's birthday. Was it Bo? Or was it Lou? I think it was Lou.
It was Lou.
Yeah, Lou did a fantastic artwork of with Sheeran in the little bottle.
I remember that one, yeah.
That was cool. And the 300 plus on the cake. That was great. What else was there? Oh, yeah, Jai Courtney. What the hell is going on there, guys? Jai Courtney in the full mocap suit with the facial capture on skates.
Yeah.
That's like a big teaser.
Did you guys see my poll earlier this week about whether or not Jai Courtney should get jacked and get the long hair to have the actual Joshugon look, or should he just, you know, stay
Of course.
Yes, absolutely. Dude, I can't wait for that. If that's what's coming up, then you know I'm juiced for that. I love me some Joshugon, man.
He gave me some
Jay Mullet.
Oh, that would be great to give him a mullet. Dude, if he had like the Joe Dirt mullet with all the Joshugon armor on, that would be perfect.
That would be awesome. I would like to see him be closer to the manga version and like really the beefed up guy we know and love. And yeah, I'm wondering about this pose because a few were also not thinking maybe is it a kind of pitch that they are trying to get together to present it for Disney.
I handed you the card.
No, and it's not sure. Just the latest. The latest thing he has written there, there was a post again where he basically people asked what is it about, and he said just NDA, non-disclosure thing, you know? Yeah. So, yeah. So you don't want to talk about that at all.
Yeah, man. I
hope it's a pitch. Because if that's a green light pitch, Rodriguez said today that if they get it green lighted, they could basically start shooting in 4 months because that was what he said in the article about the first one. Like the green light process is the hardest, and after that, it's a piece of cake.
Well, actually, in Landau's interview earlier this year, he said that they don't have a full script for the sequel, so they would have to spend 6 months writing the script. So it's once the script is completed, they could then in 4 weeks start filming, but they need a script first.
Yeah.
And I guess they're just not going to spend the money and the time writing a script if the movie isn't off the ground. Okay. What other news? So basically our tweet storm was covered by a bunch of online media reporting agencies. Again, comic book, who else? Cinema Blend, Vice, as we mentioned. So it got a reasonably good amount of coverage. There's a few people here who got their tweets mentioned. Love Alita got mentioned quite a few times. There were some tweets there that really hit home. Dennis got one of his tweets mentioned as well in this article. So congratulations, Dennis. Mexican was mentioned. Yasin, Salaya. A lot of these people I don't know specifically, but obviously they're Alita Army that don't get involved in all the general discussions in tweets. But Astro X Omega, Jam957, and Bostich.
Also, Vladi got, I think, one or two times mentioned.
Yeah. So we're being seen, and it's getting out there. So that's important. Our efforts are not going unnoticed.
And also, Crunchyroll talked to us, made a tweet about that.
Oh, yes.
That's pretty big.
Now, Cranberry has asked me to throw this out there that Alita Law wants to organize a hard paper mailing campaign, not emailing, a hard paper mailing campaign to the production company, sending them physical letters, taking Pat's advice and running with it. So we'll look into that and see what makes sense for a good date and get back to you with addresses and maybe form letters or something if people aren't very good at this sort of thing. But, you know, we've tried everything else. Let's give that a shot. I figure more irons in the fire means more chances of, you know, making a Damascus blade, as it were.
Something on with that in particular as well, when I forget who mentioned it, about emails can be very, very controlled. Email accounts, like you just set one person and they set their own password. And, you know, they report to one person and say, do you want this out there? Do you want this gone forever sort of thing, even though it's not really on the internet. But with a hard copy, as I like to call it, letter, that will pass a lot of eyes. And especially when it comes from international waters, it's going to go through customs. It's going to go through two different mailing setups, companies, if you will, like the country of the origin and the country of destination. And then it has to go through Disney or Paramount or whoever's we're mailing their physical hard mail process as well. So a lot of more eyes would see it, and like you can't not undo that, I guess. As easy it would be to delete an email or at least stop people from seeing that email. I don't know.
Well, that's the hope. I mean, physical letters can be dropped in a bin just as easily as you can press the delete button. So, you know, if they want to ignore it, they can. I just hope that they wouldn't, as it were.
But the good thing is it's a switch of pace, a change of pace and a switch of gears, and it can work. It's at least something we should try.
A pile of letter makes a whole different impression than a pile of emails.
Absolutely.
Probably a lot more time consuming to throw out a pile of letters as well.
A pile of letters is a what the fuck moment. What?
Well, if you look at it that way, remember when we sent all those postcards to Rosa and she was excited and she had a physical pile of stuff that had been sent to her and she was showing it off on Instagram. So, you know, actually physically having something there, just not letters on a screen, might actually change the way people think. You just never know what effort will you know, turn that corner and make that thing a reality. So I think it's worth trying.
Of course.
And on that note, we've been going for 2.5 hours. We've had a fantastic time with Pat. I learned so much. I hope you guys did too. I might start calling this to a close at that point. Does anybody have any last bits of news that they wanted to cover? Ask that. I missed anything?
No.
Nope. Okay.
I think it went really well considering the person that Star Aurelion and a certain other someone had to do a lot of work behind the scenes. A round of applause for you.
Thank you. So that actually brings the first season, in inverted commas, of the Radio Chaos show to a close. We're actually going to have a 3-week hiatus. I'm sorry if people have got used to listening to things at this time and would like some more, but it's actually quite a bit of work to put this together. You don't see what goes on behind the scenes. And it's summertime in the US. People need a break. People need to get out and do things. So we're going to take 3 weeks off, and we're going to come back on the 22nd of August with hopefully a stream called Who Are We and How Did We Come to Enjoy the Battle Angel Alita Manga? So we're going manga, we're going old school. So we'll be looking for guests to come on and talk about their manga experiences a bit closer to the time. And in the downtime, I will be hunting around for more special guests to come on. Hopefully Pat will tell other people she knows who've been involved in the movie who might want to come on. And we're just going to try and work our way up the chain to the big names if we can swing it. But always keep asking. Get out there on Twitter and say, hey, we've got this thing. When it comes back late August, we would love to have you on and just see what people say. Be pleasant, be clear and concise, and tell them about all the people who've already come on and enjoyed it. And we'll see who we can get on for the next season, in inverted commas. So I want to thank Pat Cadigan, who probably won't hear this because she's gone to bed, but I want to thank her again. It was fantastic to have her on. And the book nerds here, myself and Cranberry, we were PMing to each other or DMing in Twitter, geeking out about the book side of things. That's fantastic. And remember, if you want to come on the live stream, there is a sign up form. It's in the Google Docs. Do revisit it. If you've come up with a new idea and want to suggest a topic for a show, we're always looking for new and diverse topics. So jump back on that form if you haven't been on there for a while. Update your entry if you haven't been brought on to do something. It's again the same philosophy of keep, you know, throwing things out there and eventually something will stick. And that's what we want to do. We want to get our sequel. We're going to keep putting the good ideas out there and be positive, and we're getting our sequel. It's just a matter of time now. So thank you, this week's guests, for coming on. Obviously, Pat. Thank you, Cranberry, for coming on and helping out with the questions there. And first-timers, Liam, and, of course, David, thank you all for coming on.
There you go.
And thank you, our listeners, for joining us. You are what makes the fandom special, and that's why we do this. We hope that you won't forget about us in the next 3 weeks and come and join us on the
22nd. Thank you for putting on this show.
You're very welcome, Liam.
Thank you,
Liam,
for being with us.
Yes. And feel free to sign up for another show if there's another topic you're interested in. We're happy to have you. So on that regard, thank you guys all so much. And as the usual call to action, 3, 2, 1.
Bye.
Thanks very much, and see you on the 22nd. Bye for now.
You know, back when I was in the academy, we would follow every toast with a song.
Hilda, Hilda, oh, God. Yasha, Hilda, Yasha, Hilda.
Hilda, Shiri, Skandar. Hilda, Shiri, Skandar. Cheers.